All right, hello everyone, and welcome back to the English coverage of the Dota 2 Professional League group stages. This is going to be a two-game series between EHOME Luminous and Wings. Should be one to keep your eye on. It's going to be some awesome plays all around. I'm going to be your caster, Annie, and I am being joined once again by Mott Pax. How's it going, man?
Oh, it's going great. Second series of the night, EHOME Luminous. This will be the first time that I've ever had the pleasure of casting them. And then, of course, a much more well-known opponent to those of us who follow more of the kind of the tier one scene, who they have graciously managed to find their way into after winning themselves a fabulous little LAN over in Manila. They're looking to go back and hopefully do it again, at least for their sake, at the major. So the Wings are a very, very scary team right now.
Absolutely. They are certainly disciplined. They've been putting out some crazy strats too, like really getting creative, experimenting against these teams that may not be seeded as highly as them. Not necessarily free wins for them, but they are able to play around a little bit against other teams and play with their draft. They are going for the Rubick here. I like the Rubick a lot. I think it has the potential to perhaps steal a Doom. We've seen some counters on that so far this tournament, and we'll see what else EHOME Luminous pick up that Rubick can get his hands on. And the Tidehunter, obviously one of the most in-demand picks this patch, just because it's such a stable offlaner. It offers you some really nice position 3 support items, and then you have the luxury to get away with a greedier core, or perhaps even a jungler. And Wings, they go for that support Ricky. What do you make of that?
The old fake bounty hunter. Lots of early aggression. Could be looking for a mid laner that could help out with that. Maybe someone who has a stun, someone that can provide enough of a nuke, like even a death prophet or something, where you can kind of add on to the slow that's already coming out there from the smoke screen if you end up going to strategy like that. It just works when it comes to actual kills than a lot of other, than the bounty hunter, right? So, good. Make sure that Doom doesn't have a good time if he decides to go for the full out 4 roll in the jungle, too.
Yeah, that's going to be a lot of fun here. So EHOME, they have the opportunity now to snag up a mid laner that's not going to get punished too hard from the Ricky. We've seen some interesting courier snipes already today, but what do you think EHOME pick up here? Do they go with the tried and true Dragon Knight, or do they pick up something different?
Well, you're definitely thinking about something tanky. When it comes to survivable, the puck doesn't help because of the silence. Let's see, the slow is 25%, and your puck, so you won't, you'll die. Okay, puck would die. So we're going to go with, because typically that's the hero that you always look towards. Bounty Hunters, Earth Spirits, right? These are very normal rotations that come in. The silence is so, so sore from the Earth Spirit, it's not a concern at all. You throw out your orb, you jaunt yourself there. You're not going to have the best time, you're not going to dominate the lane, but you do survive, you get your levels, and then you'll just either have a support rotate to kill the mid with your Dream Coil, or you counter-initiate in another lane, and things go fine. DK, not relying on any of his spells, of course, for his own survivability, makes him kind of the most likely choice when it comes to trying to deal with this Ricky. But then we all know that your DK kind of starts to pigeonhole you a little bit, at least, into some sort of a style, right? You want to make use of those Elder Dragon forms and everything like that. Personally, I kind of like a mobile, okay, they'll go with the Timber. I was going to say like a mobile, a mid-hero like a Storm Spirit or something, because Wings, they already have the Rubick and the Tidehunter and the Ricky, but when it comes to their cores, they don't tend to pick a lot of, like, lockdown heroes. In a lot of cases, the Beastmaster's already removed, but, like, these guys run, like, Core Venno, right? It's stuff like that, so Timber should fit in pretty well here.
Alright, yeah, the Timber Saw is going to be an interesting pick, and that does give time for Wings to deal with it. They can pick up something decent against it. Do you pick up, you know, how do you get away with just playing against a Timber Saw? Do you pick up something that doesn't care about the constant harass? Do you pick up something that has kill potential? Because right now, Wings, they've got a nice rotation for, or rather, a nice lineup for rotations to the mid lane. How do you even lock down a Timber Saw, though? Do you pick up a DK for yourself?
Well, things are starting to come into a little bit of a clearer picture, so it should be, in fact, the mid, because, I mean, we still see quite a bit of, like, that offlane Timber Saw with the max armor is just, I mean, even the mid laners are starting to max it, too, but the reactive armor is just, you're unkillable, as you kind of said there, so will the Ricky be enough? I highly doubt it. You're really dealing with a Tidehunter. Now, you don't buy BKB on Timber Saw, which is not always the best, but it's highly unlikely you can bring him down during the Ravage, so Timber Saw is just looking overall fantastic here, but that laning stage is very crucial, right? Got to get up into that Bloodstone. So we're dealing with a Slardar, which we assume will be the offlane. So we're, I suppose this will be the position once we already have a Tidehunter. Well, this will be one we haven't seen in a while, and I like that, because you got to get aggressive on this Timber Saw, hunt him down, and don't let him get into that Bloodstone.
Yeah, I mean, there's always the chance it's a jungly Tidehunter, but it's just not nearly as viable as the offlane. So most likely Shadow taking up that Slardar, and we still have yet to see any love for the Invoker. And Wings, their mid laner, does love the Invoker, plays it fantastically. That's gonna be the last ban, in fact.
Tinker.
Oh. Yeah, I think the Windranger ban.
Oh,
kind
support
of.
Doom, Timber, offlane, mid Tinker.
All right, there we go. I like it. The mid Tinker.
So,
oh, talk about mobile, looking out for the stuns and everything. Sorry, I should be hunting down this Tinker. And the Storm Spirit's still there, but there's a Doom, so might not want to go for that.
Ooh, this is a draft storm. Here. I guess EHOME.L, they're trying out some crazy strats, because it's going to be... Lane's being pushed a lot. Tinker has to just not die in lane, and then he can be really successful in the late game, also always keeping the push up. Because right now it looks like Wings are going to be rotating as a group. They're going to have the Ricky roaming around, but Rubick, Tidehunter, Slardar, and whatever other mid-core they pick up is going to be probably sticking together, looking for those ganks, looking for those picks altogether. So as soon as everyone leaves a lane, Tinker TPs in, throws down March of the Machines, pushes it out, and gets some free push there, and we'll see where the Timbersaw goes. Sometimes he could go for that more utility build and go and be a lane pusher as well, or he could stick with his team and be a nice zoner.
Well, judging by their kind of like recent picks and everything like that, going into the position once, they don't tend to draft a lot of like those lockdown heroes. The Ember Spirit's already gone if you're thinking about someone that at least can try and keep pace with this Tinker. They just banned out the Windranger themselves when it comes to like the mid heroes that could be helping this one out, right? Oh, then again, could be a mid tide up against the Timbersaw. I actually hadn't considered that.
It could be, and that would force it into offlane Slardar, which I believe Faith Beyond has run before, but he's more comfortable with those zoning heroes, like a Darkseer, so, and a Beastmaster, so not going to go there. They will go for a Storm Spirit.
They will go for the Storm, yeah.
You talked about mobility, and I think that's a pretty solid pick. The problem is the damage on Wings. They're going to have to build Ricky into a semi-carry probably earlier than you'd like, and Slardar, he really has to get up into those fights. You have to rely on Storm Spirit getting those vortexes through. You have to rely on Tidehunter getting off a really nice Ravage, so we'll have to see. As Wings, they're trying for something here, but I think EHOME Luminous, they just picked up a quirkier draft, and I really love what they're doing.
Yeah, the Storm Spirit's like the go-to counter versus the Tinker, like all time, right? This is just the one that immediately comes to mind, but in a draft like this for EHOME, they already had the Doom. So it's kind of like number one counter already to a Storm Spirit. Like, do you really want to be bringing that in up against the Tinker? Well, if you can avoid the Doom, which can be a little bit difficult, like if he gets that Blink Dagger up, or the more popular one today is the Shadow Blade. I think he might just be the Blink because of how crucial this Doom is going to be on top of the Storm Spirit for this game. But if you can get into just like the Stomp, that's enough time to always get off that Doom animation, because it's a little bit longer than the animation getting the Ball of Lightning. But the Stomp does give you enough time to actually set up into that one. So as long as he doesn't get interrupted by anyone else, if he dooms up that Storm Spirit, we all know how these fights are probably going to be going down. You know, you look at their damage, and overall, they don't have a lot that actually syncs up with this Amplified damage to do anything to, like, a greater deal with that minus armor. There's no, like, Wind Ranger or anything like that, right?
Yeah. I don't know. It feels like Wings have the potential to fall really, really flat if EHOME get off the ground, and it's going to come down to laning phase. It's going to come down to, can the Ricky get a snipe on Tinker's bottle? Because that would be enough to really, really set things back.
The other thing will be this whole Timbersaw versus Tidehunter. I can't tell if this will probably be like the most boring lane.
It's just going to be like
you're ever going to see
two big brick walls running into each other over and over again.
And yeah, just trying to get as many creeps as they can. He's not going to start with the Cooling Blade. I've seen a couple Timbersaws do this lately, and they're in a place where they can actually contest for CS with their right-click, and they might go for that, but they'll just rely on his spells, maybe go into that earlier Soul Ring, of course, getting the Bloodstone eventually anyway, and just a little bit of sustain in the lane. The other lane should be pretty interesting, as we do have a Storm Spirit, and it's going to be needing a little bit of help, so how much, how many of his friends will be hanging out in the mid lane during the start? Of course, the Ricky. Most anime times, Ice makes it over with this fantastic golden cape. Oh, wow. Thank you, Val, for finally patching that one and making sure it works again.
Yeah, we saw it picked up by Ice before, and he is just... This guy is decked out. He is straight pimping. Gold staff, gold... Wow. That is neat. So, more expensive cosmetics win games, but over here we do have Innocence walking into a big thing. He does scout out maybe something as Un bumps into him, but... doesn't scout out, or doesn't rather commit resources to get the dust onto Ricky, and It's gonna be Tidehunter walking in. He's super, super tanky. Levels up Gush first, and looks like they're gonna secure a 1-1 rune split. Innocent's in trouble. There's gonna be a roll up onto the Tidehunter. It misses the mark, but they can go for the body blocks now. He eats his way through the trees. The body block is real. The whirling death comes out. Faith Beyond. He doesn't have the point in the Kraken shell, so he's super squishy. Can they get him down? Well, he's gonna pop into the self. But Tidehunter offlane leveling Gush first. How's that gonna affect his laning phase?
Oh, it's god awful. I was actually watching the bottom. Why didn't he level Gush? What did it even do? Did it save his storm?
He was not really saving anything. He went and like gushed someone up who was standing here. You can't see that, can you?
This is like
who
when
was standing
a,
here to get the slow, so they couldn't run onto the rune. But it just didn't work out, as they didn't get the rune either way.
Yeah, it's pretty bad, right? Like this is when your Lich has to take like Frost Blast or something at the rune, or your Crystal Maiden takes Crystal Nova, and then she can't scale up better into like farming jungle camps or whatever with her W. This is pretty bad. He just doesn't even want Gush until like level 5 at the earliest, sometimes even after, right? And you just really need that Kraken Shell as well as that Anchor Smash, but at the very least, there won't be that many right clicks coming out from the Timber Slot. It'll mostly just be the fact that he's going to pull the creeps to himself so he gets reactive stacks, and then therefore the Dire Creeps will be attacking the Tide, and if he doesn't have those early points in a Kraken, like right now, he's going to take a lot of harass because he's not going to set up the Stout Shield because no one does as a Tide Hunter, right?
Yeah, I mean, he's got those big chunks of regen. He already popped his self, he already ate 2 tangos, and he's gonna get back up to where he should be, and Innocent's gonna go, we'll leech some XP eventually, but for right now, still sitting at 0 XP in this game, and Timbersaw already level 2.5, so that's really the discrepancy showing off. Now, is there gonna be rotation in the roll? Doesn't connect, but he will go in for more body blocks. I think they may just have to 1v1 this. They bring in the Witch Doctor as well, who has the Maledict first. I like that pick a lot up against the Tidehunter, and I don't think they have enough damage, but they will force him back, perhaps all the way to base, as Ricky now goes in, slapping out the Witch Doctor. He's gonna pop down a sentry, may end up going down the counter sentry, though, eating up that ward. I love that play by Innocence. So cocky, all up in your face, and he's gonna go through and perhaps continue to harass out the Witch Doctor.
Yeah, really quickly done there, so make sure you keep control of that. Very important as a Ricky or a Bounty Hunter, doesn't really matter.
Roll on in! Storm Spirit is in trouble, doesn't have the zip, not even close to it. They don't have the laser, it's on cooldown, 2 seconds, 1 second, and they will end up getting the first blood there, courtesy of the Heat-Seeking Missile. So, Freeze really getting a lot done in this mid lane. He's going to be keeping up in terms of farm, he's going to be keeping up in terms of kills, and now Ice going through, trying to get some space. He's hasted up, he wants to make something happen, he's got the telekinesis off cooldown, or rather on cooldown. Now there's gonna be a TP in from the storm. Do they reinitiate here, or Nash is gonna be Rubick walking on back through the jungle?
Yeah, we all know that Storm's always gonna have himself a pretty rough laning phase, and that Rubick just happened to play so close, and with the Tinker now being down this low, he can make himself a little bit of a rotation back down bottom, get a pull off, because the Slider's lane's getting out of control, right? It is suffering because of this movement from the Ricky as well as from the Rubick, so a lot of free experience going off this Doom right now, and oh, he actually did it. I can't believe it.
Your kill on there. It's not on anything. They didn't get the bottle snipe as the bottle was already on Freeze, so not huge, but definitely still delaying the Timbersaw's, or rather the Tinker's potential.
Oh no. Oh yeah, that's just my furnace going. Don't worry. Sorry. I gotta heat the house. It's candle, guys. I'm sorry. I know it's like a
It is like 98 furnace. Degrees here.
That's how she goes.
Alright, we've got a Tidehunter, he does put 2 points in the Anchor Smash. He still has no Kraken Shell. He still has no shout. There you go. He picks up Kraken Shell for the first point at level 4. I don't understand. It's such a good spell, and that's what makes Tide a great offlaner. Now he's going to be able to play a little cockier. Oh, Innocence gets blasted down. Heat-Seeking Missile. Now they're turning things around. They want to double kill onto the Storm as well. They've got no mana left for their laser, so Storm will get away, but that was costly. Ricky rotates in, and he's just not as aggressive as he wants to be.
Yeah, unfortunately, just because of the dynamics of this lane, like, and the fact that he had that Gush early on, you do need the 2 points in the Anchor Smash to contest CS versus the Timbersaw. We talk about the Kraken Shell, it's important versus the creeps, but of course, Tidehunter, or rather the Timbersaw, doesn't actually right-click you, right? So you don't get a lot of value out of it in some ways.
Yeah, I don't know, I feel like if there's a successful gank by the Witch Doctor with that level 1 Maledict, it could be enough to get down the Tidehunter, because he just doesn't have any way to deal. He's just not beefy. Because it's super non-meta to go for a Stout Shield here, even though, I don't know, with that skill build, I would have guessed the Stout Shield, and they're going to go in, one more Timber Chain could secure his death, but just an effective zone for now. Radiant, they're moving their supports, and they've got Ice on the back lines, looking for that Telekinesis. They got the Fade Bolt as well, they get the lift, they are going to go through the Fade Bolt, and that's going to be perhaps a kill. Drop the Fade Bolt, man, no mana, but the right click will secure the kill. Now mid lane, they might have to trade out Storm, nice kill there, getting down the Earth Spear before he gets taken down himself, and now there's a rotation back in to the bottom lane, and Ice just going to go get himself some farm. Get himself some levels. He's already level 3. He picks up 2 points in that Fade Bolt.
Yeah, DD Runes, man. They've been, like, stories in the games today.
Storm? You overstayed your welcome there, buddy. He just stood there watching a TP come
not
through.
Not level 6.
I don't know. I feel like that kill could have been very much avoided. Speaking of kills, we are going to have Faith Beyond once again tick it down to a Maledict. They have the Timber Chain. Can they line it upright? And does Un want to dive? He does go through. They've got the Whirling Death. Can he get close enough? Get in there, man. And it's going to go through. They will secure the kill. Witch Doctor picking up the gold for that one.
Yeah, just one of those reasons. We started seeing the Witch Doctor in the first place. It's like fantastic against the Beastmasters and fantastic against those Tidehunters. Really good use of the Maledict here. Yeah, the 2-1-1 build is a skill that often just gets ignored unless you have a really beefy offlaner. You might see it a couple times against your newfound Timbersaws.
Roll
too.
On through. Deep dive will secure the kill on the Storm Spirit. That is Storm Spirit's third death so far of the game. I think they've got to calm down just a little bit. Down bottom, we do have Fade Bolt coming out. There's going to be a lift back up. I think they get the kill on the Doom. One more hit should do it. The Scorched Earth is not enough to keep him up alive. That's going to be Slardar picking up a really nice first kill. He's going to be going straight into that armlet, and we'll have it up quite shortly.
I haven't got to see a nice and aggressive Slardar in so long. All my Slardars have been offlane in all the games I've been casting lately, but I really dig the position 1. Armlet into Blink. Oh, Faith Beyond again.
Yeah, I mean, probably regretting that it didn't go at least a little tanky. Picks up the Bracer to get some HP, some armor, and now Witch Doctor is going to be tossing out that... actually already tossed out the cask, and one more Timber Chain. Can he light it up? Can he go through? Finally, the Maledictic wears off. He needs to get something more. One more hit will do it. The Chakra, I'm going to be slightly off the mark.
He's going to regret this if he doesn't mango for this.
Faith
Beyond. He's not going to do it!
Yay! That was almost an awesome deny to neutrals. At least Faith Beyond bought a lot of space, as Timbersaw's not there to soak XP. But in the end, Tidehunter going down twice.
Oh, what a lift! Oh, down here, plays! Catches a mid-roll. Oh, that was sick. Ice. He went for the double kick stun, and it was looking so good for the Earth Spirit, and he went for the roll. Nice, nice, managed to get the lift off just in time.
You're just like tearing into the map with your ability to draw on it, man. I love it.
I gotta spell it out, guys. You know, I gotta let you know what happened. That was also really funny up top, by the way, because like all this time, like the Kraken Shell, the fact that he had the Gush first, and then it's like, oh, I only got the 1 point in the Kraken Shell. This lane's a little bit harder now because of it. I haven't even used my Gush since then. And then his only 1 point in the Kraken Shell. Again, still enough to make sure that he can't get denied by neutrals. Just like can't win with the skill today.
Yeah, I mean, Tide, he's got his shoes, but he did stop to go for the Bracer. He's been out of lane for a decent amount of time, so no arcanes on the horizon. Blink is a long way off, so he's going to really delay his teamfight presence and set his team back. And you've got a team like Wings going up against EHOME, and EHOME have a Timber and a Tinker. Any minute that you can get online before Timber and Tinker become a problem is great for Wings. They've got to get their teamfight potential rolling as soon as possible, so a delayed Tide is just a little bit of a handicap in the road.
Yeah, delayed Tide, delayed Storm Spirit, lot of weight on Shadow's shoulders for this game for sure. And the problem is he really still can't get going until he's that Blink Dagger. Like, Armlet's great. You think about like a Lifestealer or something, he gets his Armlet, maybe his Phase Boots, and he's ready to rock and roll. But not quite as easy, right? We don't have initiating supports, we don't have something like a Disruptor here for the side of Wings that can kind of create a fight for you in situations where maybe you shouldn't have one, and without any sort of a need for items. It's a Ricky and a Rubick, so unless they overextend from the side of EHOME, it's very hard to actually get the Slardar ball rolling, and he's the one who has to also propel the Storm Spirit into that state.
Two scans used here by each team revealing their own territory, I believe, so that's going to be very defensive scans used to make sure there's no ganks in the mid, no ganks down here, and group up three heroes there. They've got the Doom online. They want to get that done. Right at level 6, he starts rotating to get the most out of this. If they get the Doom on the Storm, a Storm is only level 7. That could be huge. They're going to go in, just force him back, force him under tower. And meanwhile, up top, we've got a gate coming in. There is Slardar with a sprint, but no Blink. Looks like Witch Doctor will get crushed up. Gonna be a relatively not that best trade if Slardar ends up going down. It's gonna be a Ravage committed. They get Una under his own tower, but Faith Beyond will end up going down. That is a dead Tidehunter for like the zillionth time this game. And now Shadow, he's there. He's trying to get tanky, but we'll take a Doom. That is a heavy commit for what was most likely a dead Slardar anyway. Now TP out. Can they get anything against it? They don't have any stuns for now, so they will let Rubick off with a warning, but that was...
Oh, another Pele? No, can't bend it like Beckham, unfortunately. Does have to go in a straight line.
He's selling stuff. They're gonna go in. They're gonna get him. They force him back in the cliff. And this is just Wings giving up a lot of free space around the map. They went in for what seemed like a free gank up top, and yeah, you got a Witch Doctor, but you give up two heroes, and then your mid laner dies again. The kills are just not looking great here. That was Storm Spirit's fourth death, Tidehunter's third. and no one's really winning. I mean, I guess the big winner here is Ricky. Like, he hasn't died yet.
Getting that solo experience bottom, but yeah. Like, this is exactly what the problem is with their heroes and their lineup, is that the Slider has this pressure, we've talked about it, where he has to get things going. He has to try and get some kills, and try and get the ball rolling, get into his Blink Dagger, and everything else like that. And he just, like, wraps around and dives a Witch Doctor into the tower. But EHOME are not behind. You know, they're quite ahead right now, so they're very comfortable just TPing to that tower and punishing your position one, who's way too deep. With everything that they have, and they end up getting, you know, the secondary kill into the support too, so everything just heading EHOME's way. This game doesn't get any better as time progresses here for side, unless you get to, like, mega late game Storm Spirit. So they have to be very cautious over these next 10 minutes here for Wings, just to make sure they don't fall any further behind, and that they do create some sort of, like, farming mechanisms here for these two heroes between the Storm Spirit as well as the Tide, because we all know that Storm does not have that bounce back mechanic that he once did. Like, these cloak auras and everything, the camps, they don't fall too easy.
Yeah, I mean, he's already fallen behind in terms of net worth, being outdone by that Timbersaw and the Slardar. The Tinker's just roaring up this last, or rather the net worth chart, and there's going to be a full smoke up with these initiating supports. They don't have the Doom online, but they do have the Infernal Blade. They have that Shockwave coming out. So we'll see if anyone bumps into each other. If there's going to be a counter group up, Slardar does pick up his treads, so he's a little bit more survivable, but we'll see who's going to bump into who. As, they're rotating on through, they might find out the fact that Rubik is pulling this camp, and, gonna be a successful pull through, but Ice might be in some serious trouble. He's gonna go through. Does he have time to react? Bowler comes through. Will not connect, as there is gonna be a crush onto the Earth Spirit, but they just lose the Rubik like it's nothing underneath the tower. They are gonna go through. The boulder kick does not connect. Shadow slithering away for all it's worth. They rotate in the Tidehunter, who does have the Ravage. Media Pop connects onto all five heroes, and they will get down the Timbersaw. So Radiant, they're finding something out of this for the roll, the re-engage. There is a Doom onto Shadow. He's running away. They might get the kill here onto the Timber. They do drop down the Timber. Infernal Blade comes out onto Faith Beyond. Faith Beyond is actually quite tanky. The Gush actually doing some work, and there is gonna be the Ricky with the smoke screen. They will get down the Doom as well. So Wings, they've done it. They turned around this fight. It was almost terrible, but that Ravage in from the TP was amazing.
Yeah, I think this is just, Wings maybe showing a little bit of their kind of now earned veteran status. These guys have been together for quite a long while, long before they kind of made this little recent rise to fame. They definitely one of those squads that stuck together, trying to build things up, trying to become a real tier one team. Is the scouts here maybe hoping for another courier running through here from Innocence, but that was just like veteran, you know, 900 TPs and five heroes way too deep from EHOME. A little bit of a mistake there. Like, look at their lineup. Why are they so deep right now when all these lanes are pushing, all these lanes can be farmed? Could be a Timbersaw top, a Tinker mid, and a Doom bottom. They don't necessarily need to make this risky push.
Ricky just stood there and took a lot of damage. I thought I was going to go in for the smoke screen, the backstab, and the tricks of the trade to try to get down the Tinker, but instead just sits there and takes away most of his life. He does have the Tranquil Boot, so he's able to get it back, but again, a very quirky play. Now Un is going to be going through farming up this camp. There's a big rotation in from Wings. Do they look for the pick here? Because he's super, super mobile. They might start things off with Innocence and that smoke screen. They do have the Tricks of the Trade again. They do have the Blink Strikes off cooldown. There is a tower, so they can't commit too deeply. Storm Spirit zipping in a little bit off the mark. He does end up getting the zip in. They will get the kill onto the Timbersaw. It costs them a 5-man rotation, though, and down bottom, Dire are completely content to push off of that. Dire's
top tower is under attack. It'll just end up being a little bit of a trade here. Our Bloodstone being worked on here by our Storm Spirit, definitely the expected item, but the mechanism will be first here for Faith. So this is saying that they are still comfortable with grouping up here. I mean, you just saw their little pickoff play there, but sometimes you might see like a Blink Dagger in the situation, even though it's pretty much fallen to the secondary item. I would say it's probably like 70-30 at this point, where the mechanism is more often the one to come out first. But sometimes you'll see in this situation where you need to set up for something when you're a little bit behind, right? Like maybe prepping up for your own Blink Dagger here for Shadow. You're kind of like the pseudo-blink for him. But I like the mech too. It's just going to allow them to fight, and they just need to be a little bit more careful about their general
positioning.
Oh, speaking
of fight, there's a lift. There's an Earth Spirit that just barely lives to hit the ground. He's trying to get out. He kicks up. He gets a really nice stun, dropping the Magnetize as well. He's still alive somehow. He's rolling on through. Ice may end up falling here. The Magnetize doing so much work. Ricky popping out of the Tricks of the Trade. They commit the Doom onto the Slaughter. They will get the kill there. Now this is a re-engage from EHOME.L. They're looking for Faith Beyond, who does have the Ravage. Not going to find a great angle for it this time. So in the end, it's only the Slaughter that drops. Innocence drops very low. Ice as well, but they turn it, they get two in return, so it's not too terrible. That just delays Slaughter's progress on this Blink much further.
Yeah, it is the ideal target right now in a lot of ways for EHOME. I mean, they'll be very happy trying to slow down that Bloodstone as well for the Storm Spear, but in terms of overall fight potential, that Slayer is a big part of it right now for Wings, is just trying to get up into that Blink. At least this will be, assume it'll be likely the item here. But once that Bloodstone does come online for a Storm Spirit, that is where Tinker's life gets much harder.
We're trying to zip away. We'll get lifted up into the air. They pop the Ravage? I hang a coral kill secured. On
your could have been that they, well, in general, actually, they had pretty decent map vision, so...
Again, you know, as long as you got that kill, man. I guess maybe Wings aren't anticipating fighting for the next 2 minutes, but that seemed like a quite... intense cooldown just for the Timbersaw kill. I guess the threat of a Ravage no longer becomes scary when EHOME have something like a Doom, but alright, that happened.
Yeah, the thing is, like, I think EHOME made a mistake once when they did that big push down bottom, and I don't think they'll make it again. Like, why bother bringing in 5 heroes in all these situations? Is they're actually gripping up a little bit here, at least with the supports and the Doom here. Perhaps there's a hopeful bait with the Tinker.
I mean, yes, they do have that
three
smoke.
Rockets.
Yeah. On the Witch Doctor. Maybe
I think he's gonna join them. So they'll be looking to smoke up near a wave, right? That's the ideal situation. Tinker just like shows top so that he can just push at the wave. And then yeah, he'll just TP in whenever you guys are gonna be going for some sort of a play.
And we'll see if they snap up the rune here, show some restraint, because that invis rune would be neat. Now they are gonna bump into Innocence. Their smoke all breaks, so Innocence knows something's up. He dips into the Roche Pit. That's kind of scary. They are gonna go through there. Look at their roll. Not gonna catch out anything. They dust for a Ricky, but the Ricky popped the smoke over here.
And now his smoke is still propped there, or is still on as well from the Earth Spirit. So just a little bit of panic mode. Probably someone saying, "Oh, we pop!" Like use your dust, or like go one direction and dust. And yeah, unfortunately picked the wrong one.
All right, so that's two plays in a row that are a little bit quirky in this game. So maybe each team is relaxing for this series.
It was definitely like well read as well from Wings, because this lane was pushing the whole time, and the Tinker never dared make the rotation because he also wasn't quite sure, I don't think, where they were. But anytime there's creeps hitting a tower, you're smoked up. Like, that's just how it is, right? Why else would there be creeps hitting a tower unless they're making some sort of an invasion into our jungle? And so it's just so unlikely that you're gonna get a pick off onto Wings when you're not pushing out a full lane, especially with a Tinker on your lineup.
Exactly, and speaking of the Tinker here, he has picked up his Boots of Travels, obviously, has the Blink as well, has about 700 more gold to work with, and he is getting some decent pressure into the lane, and Wings don't have the best lineup to deal with that counter pressure. Like, yeah, you got the Storm Spirit, but in the late game, that's really it for how you deal with creep push, so Wings have to find themselves an advantage soon if they really want to counter EHOME's draft.
Yeah, well, this is the time. That Bloodstone. I just want to kill that Tinker like 6 times in a row right now. That would be kind of the dream, right? Hope you can kind of camp his lanes here. It's almost kind of easy at this point, simply because they still have tier 1s. Like, there's actually not big real estate down here for a Tinker to appear, so Storm could just be farming this jungle, and coming down here for the Tinker is actually a little bit dangerous. He's not going to be punished this time. Their Storm is hanging out in the pit. Who is scanning the Roche Pit? Who is doing that?
It's scanning outside the pit.
Okay,
they know,
yeah,
no,
I just had to double check. We had some issues during the Manila Major, you know. People weren't reading patch notes.
Man, those patch notes, they hide that from you. You gotta scan deep for that one. Now, going on in, Owen is going to be picking up that Soul Ring. He should be getting close to that Bloodstone here. The Soul Booster needs about 2k more gold. Oh, Innocence. Innocence got him out. They dunk the Infernal Blade. They get the dust. There's going to be an Initiate in from the Earth Spirit as well. The Tricks of the Trade has to end sometime. And now, a nice Smoke Cloud from the Ricky. He will still just sit there and take the damage. Timbersaw getting the kill for that one with the Chakram. They rotate and freeze, which is maybe a little bit unnecessary. You'd like him to continue his push elsewhere around the map.
Yeah, speaking of pushed around the map, though, like, Wings are really getting it done here. Considering that they really don't have the best heroes when it comes to overall, like, lane push, especially when you're up against a Tinker and a Timbersaw, who both do a pretty fantastic job of it. Like, Shadow, it's crazy to see him farming this far up and even, like, going into these camps in such dangerous and hazardous situations, but some good aggressive warding's been spotting on a lot of these rotations. It does get more dangerous now, though, because the initiation potential has just gone up with this Blink Dagger on top of the Timbersaw. Nice early pickup, looking to get aggressive. And I think it's because they know that the fight's going to be coming soon with that Storm Spirit, because you can look at the Wings draft and how they need to get things going right now. They want to make use of these Ravages. They want to actually make use of this Slayer Dire, right? Like, he's ready to fight. He's starting to build into a Vanguard. There's now a Blink Dagger on the Tidehunter, and having this counter-initiation plays from the Timbersaw as well as the overall chase potential is just going to help kind of, like, protect his Tinker from the interests of Wings right now.
Yeah, and I think Wing's got to start making some plays. They got to go for the pickoffs here. If you can pick off the Tinker like twice in a row, suddenly he plummets in net worth. And Storm actually is finding a lot of ground. He had such a tough time in lane. He had 4 deaths in lane, but is going to be going in for that Orchid and should have it quite soon. And getting a nice Orchid here onto the Timber, onto the Tinker, that's essentially a free kill. They have no escape mechanism other than their spell-reliant cooldowns.
Smoke on smoke action.
Oh, we're gonna go through. They pop it up on the top lane first. They do have
not that lift. Ravage?
Ravage! 2! It's not gonna be huge, it's actually 3. Now they get the lift onto the Earth Spirit, so there's gonna be no Magnetize. Nice Crush coming out. Ricky with the Tricks of the Trade to buy himself some time, but so far it's a 3-0. All of Wings looking really, really healthy here. Can they catch up to the Ricky? Rather, the Witch Doctor. He's gonna be down in the lane. They've got that Sprint, they've got the Blink. Goes in deep, does he get the Crush? He does connect it underneath the tower. He will secure the kill. Easy for the Storm Spirit to zip it in, getting that last hit. So again, kill secured, and Wings, they get themselves a 4-man wipe. Meanwhile, Tinker wants nothing to do with that bloodbath, and we'll just sit up and farm. But this is a really big turnaround for Wings. They get the Roche, they get everything they wanted out of that, and Tinker's not even able to take a full tower off of it.
Yeah, their odds of winning this game just went up, like, I don't even know how much higher. Let's say
about,
it was
about
like
10,000
net
worth, let's say.
It's ridiculous. It's now like 70-30 for Wings. That's all it takes. Like, that one big fight, 16 Bloodstone charges now up onto the Storm Spirit, and how are you gonna kill him? Like, you're doomed. He's got the Blink. Maybe he can get it off. He's got the Blink Purge. Might have to look for something a little bit better if he wants some solo kill potential. But they gotta shut down the Storm Spirit. And now he's an Aegis, so maybe you're finally gonna be able to do it. It's probably gonna cost you Doom, judging by the rest of your other heroes, and it's actually like so unlikely right now that, if knowing how Wings play and everything, I find it extremely unlikely they can come back here. So EHOME just need to mega farm up this Tinker, get some bigger items on this Timber Saw that he's more of a threat in these fights, and really just like kill everyone else. Like, you have to almost ignore the Storm Spirit.
There's going to be a big rotation in from EHOME.L. They're going in, maybe not on the advantage. They get the roll up onto the high ground, and they have the sentry ward. I don't know if they exactly scouted that out. I don't think they have the high ground observer. But either way, Wings, they're focusing their attention towards the top half of the map, and even with a Tinker, this lane is still consistently pushing in Wings' favor. I mean, Tinker's putting in a lot of work, but he's just not having that push impact we talked about, and in draft we said that Wings don't have a lot to deal with the split push of the Tinker, but I think Wings are getting that out by just going in and killing the 4 other heroes on EHOME consistently.
Yeah, the big thing is that he just has to play the game totally differently than a normal Tinker. Like, he's just not TPing up here the whole time, and he's right to do so because they don't have control over their own jungle. Once you lose this tower, it's something else when it goes down on the Radiant side, because you can just come in and it's like unpunishable, but even on the Dire side when you lose it, it's still much easier for the Dire to take control of this, and he can't push it out because of the Storm Spirit, because of the Slayer Dire, the Blinks are online. It's just so scary. Like, a Storm Spirit will just kill you over and over and over again for a Tinker, and every time it's going to be a Bloodstone Charge, and then every time it just gets easier, and probably one of the biggest snowball effects in the entire game.
Alright, mid lane, we are going to have some sort of initiators. Freeze goes in, immediate Blink out, so Innocent's not able to capitalize with that smoke screen. Now there's going to be that Heat-Seeking Missile onto the Ricky, able to dodge it out with the Invis, and see if Radiant want to take this. They're all posturing up like they want to go in. They have that Blink Ravage, and I think they know where EHOME's hiding out. The question is this fight high ground or low ground? And it looks like it will be a back off from the Radiant. They're trying to make Dire make the first move, and Dire, they're playing this one safe. They know how behind they are. Oh, what's happening? Zip in, Storm going just all the way across the map, having some fun with it. They get the lift onto the Witch Doctor, they drag him down. That's going to be double kill for the Rubick. The Doomed up Tidehunter means no Ravage. Great target on that, but the Doom now running for his life. There is going to be a Heat-Seeking Missile. Ricky dodging it out with the Tricks of the Trade. Storm's still alive. He's got one bottle sip left. They will eventually... No kill yet. Everyone's going to be okay with that mechanism. Ricky got down to like 1 health, but Tidehunter with a great timing on that. His Doom ends. He still has the Ravage to commit. That threat of a Ravage is huge, and it means that EHOME have to back off. They have to give away this tower for free, and that means Wings found themselves that early game, mid-game advantage that they needed to counter this lineup.
Yeah, and the worst part is they didn't even get the Aegis. So it's just like 2 full more minutes of this like tyrant of a Storm Spirit who you now don't even have a Doom to deal with for a full 100 seconds. Thank you, Ice Frog. All the way up to 140 now with that new nerf that came out in the last letter patch.
It needed a nerf though.
Oh, it did. I mean, Doom did. I'm not sure if the ultimate is the part that needed to be changed here. The hero's still mega boss, but if it's almost up to that Diffusal Blade, maybe that would be enough for Innocence to actually do something about him. Get himself away. Should be fine.
I mean, Ricky, he's sitting pretty here. He is going to go ahead and TP out. And that means he does got a big rotation. Oh, Dust here. They anticipate that Ricky's still in the trees. They're committing a lot for this. They're looking for him. But little do they know, he's sitting here, full health, full mana, and a Diffusal Blade now with 8 charges, ready to go and ready to rip apart, purge off EHOME, and this is awesome.
Yeah, so we're right back at it, right? Ravage, Storm Spirit, Aegis, Doom still 45 seconds away. This should be both towers, I would imagine. I don't see anything coming out from them to actually stop them here. It's so hard to do anything as a Timbersaw until you have a Bloodstone. He's gone for this, like, attempting build with like the Blink the Urn as well as the Soul Ring, so you kind of imagine Bloodstone first gives you all these Timber Chains and you know, some additional damage and everything, of course, and all like the mana, but he'll have to use the Blink as like his first pseudo Timber, lacking all that mana he gets from a Bloodstone.
Yeah, I mean, it's 25 minutes and this Bloodstone timing is like a little bit unacceptable for a Timber at this point. You had essentially a free lane. I mean, Tad Hunter went in with some harass, but Tad Hunter died 3 times in lane. It's not like it was unstoppable. Now the tower goes down, cancels out Timber. I think Tinker's fake TP. I doubt he would have actually come in for that TP, but well, Tad Hunter going straight for the refresher. And he'll have it up quite soon. He's actually absurdly farmed. He's doing better than the Timber.
And so the old anti-tinker counter will actually take down a Timbersaw and loses Aegis in the process. And that nasty little heat-seeking missile takes care of the regen from the Aegis. That's a little bit disappointing.
Yeah, he'll go fill up his bottle here and he's gonna drink that up, get the haste rune, and dip on up to full health, full mana. So Storm Spirit's doing awesome, there's no denying that. Can Tinker wait this out? Oh, let's see here. They go for the pick. Do they have the Vortex? They cancel the TP. He's just slapping him down. Merciless here. He stands in the Merchant Machines and gets a kill. That is just violent. And that's going to be Storm Spirit on a mega kill streak. 7-4-6. Those 4 deaths in lane are not slowing him down whatsoever.
That is the first time Storm's like solo Tinker, though, I think, this whole game, right? I believe. I mean, 26 minutes, that's pretty impressive. I mean, I'm going to give you credit right there, Mr. Tinker. Like, his TPs have been pretty on point. But credit where credit's due. And also, Refresher First Tide, this it doesn't give mana anymore, right? I'm not crazy. So, he has Arcanes, he has Mech. He can't actually use everything, which is kind of funny, because he doesn't have a Force Staff. So he certainly can't take level 3 Ravage, or else he definitely won't have enough mana. So he'll be stuck at like the level 2 for a while, and he's going to have to be like extremely cautious about his mana usage. He's going to have to sync up with Ice to make sure their arcane boots are on point.
Absolutely here. Now, Roshan will be respawning up in some time here, about 2 more minutes, so we check the time on that. But EHOME.L, there's no denying right now they're playing from behind in terms of net worth. It's almost a 20k deficit at 27 minutes in, but there's a reason they're not tapping out. Is it because they're just putting so much faith in Freeze getting big, or are they looking for high ground defense, or what?
I think it's just like, hey, I haven't lost a Rax, you don't GG generally. I mean, most people just go right to the throne ends. It's also really valuable playing experience right now for them. Being Wings is a tier 1 team. I mean, they just get directly invited to a major, so I assume you will take any chance that you can as an up-and-coming squad to play against them. Make sure you get the full value out of it, try and assess what you're doing, try and make certain plays and understand how they respond. And, you know, they're still trying to win. That is definitely the number one big thing that they're going for here. Never know. You get one big Doom off that can always turn around a fight. Tinker can get into those absurd situations where you're just non-stop rocketing and lasering with those new Aghanim scepters from the high ground. So playing it out there, but you are correct. Like, they are slipping further and further behind. The Shiva's Guard, 20k lead up on this Storm Spirit. He is just like ready to become a total menace.
Yeah, I mean, we look at the net worth chart and now the Tinker is about to be surpassed by both the Slaughter and the Tidehunter, who died 3 times in lane. So It's a spooky situation. Now blink back here. Everyone a little bit scared. It's like Doom and Tide just going in and saying nope and backing on out. As we do have a Rax engage here, they will get the kill on the Witch Doctor. And that's going to be a crush here onto Oon. Can they lock down the Timber as well? They will get the kill. That's huge. Silence up on the Tinker will end up breaking. And that's going to be a 2-0. Now Wings have a high ground engage point if they want to go for it. And man, Wings are just super, super in control.
It's 22 charges now up on top of this Storm Spirit, so things are just getting ridiculous. Just diving into some racks, stacking up a couple more for himself. And Shadow, just in the meantime, he just like lived in this jungle for the first 20 minutes or so, and manages to pick up an armlet into the heart.
Storm Spirit, please relax. You are underneath tier 3s here. And the Ricky goes on through. They might end up getting a kill. The Silence, though, will save the Earth Spirit for now. They're going in onto the Doom, who is going to die with his ulti at the ready. So that's a huge thing there. They don't get the Doom off in this fight. There is going to be Heat Seeking Missiles. Innocent's not going to take one as he is still in Viz. And this is Wings just slowly but surely defeating the morale of EHOME.L. Like, that's gotta hurt. Losing heroes inside, almost under your tier 4s.
Yeah, they're not even bothering with the buildings.
Now, Tinker goes for the Aghanim Scepter, so you got bouncing lasers, but his push potential is just not the greatest.
It's interesting that this has kind of become like the default build that we're tending to see in a lot of our games. If you're enough ahead and, you know, you got enough map control, you can go for that Bloodstone. Maybe you're just like constantly doing your thing, get it like farm up here, go into the camps, do everything on a single leap. But when it comes to high ground defense, a lot of this Aether Lens into the early Aghanim Scepter, it's an absurd amount of damage. You can't really deny it. But when we start to tend to look at this team, Wings, there's a heart.
Oh.
They prep for the magic damage. Yeah, that's an easy kill.
We got another lift up, drag back down. Do they get a Witch Doctor as well? Witch Doctor hasn't had the opportunity to toss down an ult. Will go through with that Death Ward, but will eventually have it cancelled. Gets it slapped down, does some damage to the Rubik, but again, it's the Rubik, the Ravage coming out.
We'll get
Doom off in the trees, and this is looking bad here. Faith Beyond again doesn't have much mana to play with. Pops the Refresher, but no more mana for the Ravage, like you called out, and the GG is called. They don't even need the extra lockdown as Wings. They go in, they take an early lead, they snowball up 25,000 net worth advantage by the end of the game. They do
nice
end up
on the salty
pick.
Doom.
So
very important.
Alright, GG called out. Wings, they're gonna be taking game one of the series. Obviously just the more in-demand team, they're tier one, they're sitting at the top of China right now. Can EHOME do anything differently in the draft to prevent this from happening again?
Well, we have to give them some credit, of course, for that first like opening phase. They definitely did start to get a little bit of a lead. I don't even think it was like that draft oriented there. Like, they had a draft that shouldn't have been quite as good, I don't think, in the first 8 minutes or so, and yet it was. Like, they were starting to build into something, but drafting to me doesn't seem to be the biggest problem. I think it's those really early game decisions, because one thing from Wings is that in a lot of the games that they did win recent history, this kind of brought them into this like tier one status. Their laning stage, it's just been like and not so much like a full out aggression, but they just want to make sure that they get through it, and then it's like into the mid game it's all about the decision making, the map movements and everything like that. But it seems so rare that they actually get contested into that first like early game, those first key decisions. So I think if you like really take the pressure to them, make better decisions when it comes to those big tower pushes, that's the best chance that you're going to have of taking them down.
All right, so game number two coming up in just a couple of moments. Stick around for more English coverage of the Dota 2 Professional League group stages.